Hi everyone. Today I have a coding interview question, and it's a question that's being asked by Google. So in this question, you're given a tree, for example, this tree right here, and you need to write a function that takes this tree and returns the number of something called non-empty universal value trees in this tree. So what is a universal value tree? Well, it's a tree whose values are all the same. So for example, this tree right here is a universal value tree, or unival tree for short, because it only has three, and so is this one because it only has two. And if you have an empty tree, that's also technically speaking a universal value tree or unival tree. But this one is not a unival tree because you have one and two in this tree. So again, in this problem, you need to write a function that takes a tree and returns the number of non-empty unival trees. So in this example, your function should return 5 because there are 5 of those. This one, this one, this one, this one, and this one. Now just quickly, the given tree consists of a bunch of nodes, and each node has this class structure. So its class name is obviously node, and it has 3 fields: integer value, node left, and node right. And these two, left and right, are the children of each node. Now try solving this problem in O of n in time if you can, and maybe pause the video right here to think about it, and I'm gonna give you my solution in a second. By the way, this problem came from this website called Daily Coding Problem. I actually made this video in partnership with them, and they have a lot more problems just like this one on their site. You can check it out through my referral link, csdojo.io/daily. Anyway, here's my solution. Now, this solution is going to be in pseudocode, that's a little bit like Python. But in case you want my full solution in Python, I'm going to put it at csdojo.io/uni. Now, when I saw this problem, the first idea I came up with is to write a function, let's call it isUnival, which takes the root of any tree and returns true if the given tree is a unival tree or universal value tree. And then I thought I can use this function to write another function that actually takes the tree and counts the number of non-empty universal value subtrees in the given tree. So that's what I wrote. Let me show you what this function looks like. This is going to be a recursive function. And the first thing I wrote in this function is if root is equal to null, or if this is an empty tree, then sort of by definition, an empty tree is a unival tree, so it should return true. And to understand the next case, let's take a look at this tree right here. So with this tree, let's say this root right here is given to isUnival, and we're trying to find if this whole tree is a unival tree or not. Well, when we examine this tree, we'll know right away that this is not a unival tree because this value and this value are different. So basically, if the left child exists, and if the value of the left child is different from the value of the root, then it's not a unival tree. So we should return false in that case. So that's the next case I wrote here. If root.left is not equal to null, so if the left child exists, and then if root.left's value is not equal to root.value, then we should return false. We can do the same thing with the right child by writing if root.right is not equal to null, and if root.right's value is not equal to root.value, then return false. Now at this point, after going through all of these conditions, if we haven't returned yet, that'll mean that the values we've examined so far are all the same. An example of that would be if this node is given as the root. In that case, this value, the root's value, is the same as the left child's value or the right child's value, so we're not going to return until here. And here you might say, well, is that all the information we need to say that the given tree is a unival tree? Well, not quite. And that's just because if you examine the entire left subtree, there might be values that are not consistent with these three values. For example, there might be one here, and we'll never know. So to make sure that this entire tree is a unival tree, we need to make sure that the left subtree and the right subtree are both unival trees. And once we make sure that's the case, we'll know that all the values in this tree are the same, So we'll know that this entire tree is a univocal tree. And in our code, we can do that by writing this. If is univocal root.left, so if the left subtree is univocal, and is univocal root.right, so if the right subtree is univocal as well, then we'll know that the entire thing is a univocal, so we're gonna return true. And note that this condition actually takes care of the case when the left child and the right child do not exist as well. So for example, if this node is given as the root, then the left child and the right child will be null. And in that case, you know, is univocal of root.left or is univocal of null will just return true like we saw earlier. And then the same thing will happen with is univocal of root.right. So we're gonna return true in this case. And then if either the left subtree or the right subtree is not univocal, that'll mean that not all the values are consistent in the tree, so we're gonna return false. Now, how much time does it take to run this function is univocal? Well, in the worst case scenario, all the values in the given tree are the same, so we'll need to go through every single value in the given tree. And that's basically all we need to do. So this is gonna take O of n in time, where n is of course the number of nodes in the given tree. Okay, now let's take a look at how we can use this function isUnival to solve the entire problem. To do that, we're gonna write a function called countUnivals, which is gonna take the root of any tree and returns the number of non-empty univocal subtrees in that tree. This is gonna be a recursive function as well, and the base case is gonna be this one. When the given root is equal to null, that means that the given tree is empty. So in that case, we should return 0, because obviously in the empty tree, there are 0 non-empty univocal subtrees. And the recursive case is going to look like this. First, find the sum of these two values, countUnivals root.left and countUnivals root.right. So countUnivals root.left is of course the number of non-empty univocal subtrees in the left subtree, and count univocals of root.right is that of the right subtree. We want to first find the sum of these two numbers so that we can find the total number of non-empty univocal subtrees in this tree. Now, after that, there are two cases that we'll need to think about. The first case is when the given tree itself is not a univocal subtree. For example, when this tree is given. If that's the case, the number of non-empty univocal subtrees in the given tree is the total count that we just found. So it's gonna be the sum of the number of univocal subtrees in the left subtree and that of the right subtree. And the next case that we need to think about is the case when the given tree itself is a univocal subtree. Well, in that case, we need to add 1 to this total count because we need to also count this given tree itself as a non-empty univocal subtree. Okay, so we can take care of both of those cases by writing these three lines. So here what I wrote is if the given tree root is univocal, then add 1 to total count and then just return count. So that's pretty much it for this function. Now let's think about the time complexity of this function. And to think about that, you need to think about the worst case scenario for this function. Well, that might look like something like this. That's when the given tree contains only a single value, you know, repeated many times, and when it only grows in one direction, for example, to the right in this particular case. And when you call countUnivals on this entire tree, we need to first find if this entire tree is univocal or not by calling isUnival of root. And after that, we'll also need to call isUnival on this one to find if this subtree is univocal or not, and then we'll need to call isUnival on this one, and so on. So how much time does that take? Well, like we saw earlier, the amount of time it takes to run isUnival on the given tree is O of n, where n is the number of nodes in the given tree. So running isUnival on this entire tree will take O of n in time, and running isUnival on this one only will take of n minus 1 because there's one less node to consider. So we can basically add all of those up to find the total amount of time it takes to run countUnivals on this entire tree. So let's call that t of n. And that's going to be the sum of O of n and O of n minus 1 and so on down to O of 1. And if you do some calculation, you find that this is O of n squared divided by 2, which is equivalent to O of n squared. So I would say this is pretty inefficient. Actually, there's a way to do the same thing in O of n, so let's see how we can do that. The idea of this new solution is going to be that we're going to combine the two functions we've seen so far into a single function. We're going to call this function simply helper, because this is going to help another function that we're going to write. And this is going to take a tree, the root of a tree, and then it's going to return two things, a number and a Boolean value. The number is going to be the number of non-empty universal subtrees in the given tree, and the Boolean value is going to be whether or not the given tree itself is a universal. So that's basically how we're going to combine the two functions we saw earlier into a single function. And depending on the language you're using, you'll need to think about how to return those two values from this function. For example, you might want to use an array of two values. So you might want to return an array of two values from this function. Or you might want to return a tuple of two values, or maybe even an object containing these two values. Now, on top of this function, we're going to write another function, which we're going to call countUniversal2. So this is just like countUniversal that we saw earlier. It's going to take root, the root of a tree, and then it's going to return the number of non-empty universal subtrees in the given tree. And in this function, we're going to write this: total count is universal equals helper root. So here I'm assuming that this is how we can unpack the values that we're going to return from the helper function. And after running this line, all we need to do is we just need to return total count. So this function is basically just a wrapper for this helper function, which we're going to call recursively. Okay, let's now quickly go through this helper function. The first thing we're going to take care of is the base case. That's when root, the given root, is equal to null, or when the given tree is empty. Well, in that case, we need to return 0 and true, because there's 0 non-empty universal subtrees in the given tree, and an empty tree is a universal tree, so we should return true. Okay, so let's now say that we're looking at a non-empty tree, for example this one. Then the next thing we're going to do is we're going to call the helper function for the left subtree and the right subtree. And we're going to unpack those return values. We can do that like this. So left count is left universal equals helper root dot left. And then we're going to do the same thing for the right subtree. Right count is right universal equals helper root dot right. So this way, we can check the number of non-empty universal subtrees in the left subtree, and if the left subtree itself is a universal or not. And we can do the same thing for the right subtree as well. Okay, after that, we want to check if the given tree, for example this one right here, is a universal itself. And the way I'm going to do it here is that I'm going to assume that this tree is a universal. So I'm going to set this new variable isUniversal to be true, and then we're going to see if we can find any evidence that contradicts that. Okay, so first of all, if the left subtree or the right subtree is not a universal, then the whole tree is not a universal either. We can express that in code by writing if not is left universal or not is right universal, then we're going to set is universal to be false. Now let's say that the left subtree and the right subtree are both universal. Then the next thing we're going to check is we're going to check the root's value and the left node's value and see if they're the same. If they're not the same, then this whole tree is not a universal. We can express that in code by writing if root.left is not equal to null and root.left.value is not equal to root.value, then set isUniversal to be false. And we can do the same thing for the right node. So at this point, let's say that after going through all of these conditions, isUniversal is still true. Well, that's going to be the case, for example, if you're given this tree, then at that point, we'll know that this whole tree is a universal, because at that point, we'll know that is left universal and is right universal are true, and these three values, the root's value, the left's value, and the right's value are the same. So at that point, we can just say if is universal, then return left count plus right count plus one, true. And we're adding one to left count and right count to account for this given tree. And we're returning true, of course, because this is unival. And then if it's not unival, isUnival is going to be false. So else we're going to return left count plus right count. So we're not adding one here, and then false. And with this solution, we can solve this problem in O of n in time. Now that's my solution, but in case you're looking for more exercise problems, I have two extra challenges for you related to this problem. But before that, I want to first tell you guys about the website this problem came from. It's called Daily Coding Problem, as I mentioned earlier. And it's a website where you can get a daily coding problem just like this one. And if you're looking for more problems just like this one, I'd actually highly recommend it. And if you use my referral link, csdojo.io/daily, it'll let them know that you came from here, and you can get a 10% discount on their premium subscription too. But I think even their free option and the blog articles on the site are pretty good too. Anyway, here are my two extra challenges for you. Here's the first one. In this problem, you were given this node with one value and two children, left and right. But what if you're given this node instead, with one value, but with up to five children instead? How would you change your solution then? And here's the second one. We already saw a unival tree, but what if there's such a thing as a semi-unival tree where there are only two unique values in the tree? And what if you needed to find the number of not just non-empty unival trees, but also non-empty semi-unival trees, and find the total number of these two in your function? How would you change your solution then? Okay, so I'm gonna leave these two challenges as exercise problems for you guys, but maybe if you solve one of them, you know, share your solution in the comment section below so other people can hopefully learn from it. Anyway, thank you as always for watching my videos, and I'll see you guys in the next one.